The hour of seven has arrived. We'll call the meeting of the Holbrook School Committee Thursday, September 8th, to order. The first to call to order is to pledge allegiance to our nation's flag. I hope you'll join us in doing so. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The next item on the agenda and the public participation are citizens' concerns. Are there any citizens with concerns? Seeing none, we'll now turn to reports. And our first report is from our superintendent, Dr. Lally. Welcome after the beginning of school, Dr. Lally.
Thank you very much.
Please proceed.
So you can see from the enrollment report that right now we have a total of 102 kindergartners in our full-day program. We have a total of 700 children at the elementary schools and a total of 481 at the junior-senior high school for a grand total of 1,181 in the district, plus 34 out-of-district placements. So we have now 53 school choice students. Last year we did have 58. We've had a few people who have moved away, even though they were out of district to start with, they have moved elsewhere. So we have a total of 53 at this point.
What do you see encouraging and what do you see discouraging in these student enrollment figures, Dr. Lally?
Well, I think if we look at the grade 9 number, it's up from last year's. So the 10th grade is 58 students and this year's grade 9 is 76 students. So I think that is a credit to the junior senior high school and the efforts that they've made to promote staying in Holbrook. And Dr. DeMello and Ms. Moriarty have both contributed to, I think, encouraging our students as well as the other teachers and the South School too, to just talk about the advantages of staying here in Holbrook. So I think a lot of students are listening. We have the new school project, which I think is very influential in that respect.
And what about the enrollments at the lower grades?
We have a pretty steady enrollment, and I think this is going to be good for the entrance in the new school because we need to make sure that we have enough room. I don't think we have still room for school choice in the elementary school, which is too bad, but we do have a pretty steady, consistent enrollment in the elementary school, which should support our senior high school in the future.
Do any members have some questions that would like to ask?
Do you know the percentage of students that stayed, let's say that left from grade 8 to 9? Because this year it was 25%, mm-hmm. And I thought the prior year it was about 38.
Yes, I was going to say, percentage-wise, I haven't done it on our final numbers, but I think in the spring, I want to say, and Mary Beth said she may have a better, she may know off the top of her head, but for some reason I want to say last year it was something like 40%.
Yeah,
it was 40%, and this year it's about 25%.
Right.
Is that what you're saying, Mary
Beth?
Yeah.
So
that's...
Because from my perspective, that's what I was more concerned with, what was the actual percentage.
Right.
Class sizes were very different, but percentage-wise,
right,
I think we made some pretty good improvement there.
Yeah, I think that's what I thought, and that's great to go from 40% to 25%. That's a great progress.
The last year's October 1st enrollments, which since the whole world uses October 1st, has last year's grade 8, which is obviously this year's grade 9, at 107. Mm-hmm. I can check the guy. Just I have them all. I can check the.
I just did it on the June one. Was 102, so that's where I. That's what I used. Yeah.
Yeah, I just called up the October 1st because that's what everything hinges on, the October 1st enrollment. So that's what it was. Last year, the eighth grade. last year.
Well, I would like to add to this, that this is very encouraging. It's precisely the type of thing that we've been working towards or hoping, and it takes, you know, a team of dedicated administrators and faculty, as well as the parents and the entire community. And this is a community effort. It shows that when people pull for something, that you know, it's possible to make it happen. It's going to not happen overnight, but these certainly are. If the trend continues, I'll be interested in seeing the October figures. It certainly appears to be, at least perhaps for a fleeting moment, but it appears to be this year anyway, a very encouraging sign, and one that I don't think will be a fleeting moment. I think this is going to be, you know, given what we're seeing in terms of the curriculum development and the attention that each and every child gets in Holbrook and is tracked individually. I can't say that enough how unique that is. It's not unique necessarily to a public school, but Holbrook does it very, very well. And that's something that a lot of parents that spend a lot of money that go to private schools don't have, that we have, that each child isn't just part of a crowd. They're actually analyzed, they're studied, they're observed, and encouraged to, you know, to increase their strengths and hopefully pursue their dreams.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I'd like to say that I'm very encouraged by the trends that we're seeing in the enrollment data. But I also have a request, and this has come up before. I'd like to know if we could see the data in spreadsheet format so that we could better look at these trends. I think we could come up with some interesting ways to present the data.
Sure. Excel tabs all the way across so that we don't have to open individual files like I just did.
Yeah.
And I'd be willing to help organize a file in Excel to show the data.
Yeah, well, I'd say this. I appreciate your comments. They're spot on, Member Flanagan. I would add that this is one of those sort of dashboards that would be helpful, you know. And so if you're, I know you're working on those. We don't want to take your thunder away, but we would look forward to seeing that with your expertise to put that into some sort of an order. And this is probably a good example of one that makes a lot of sense for dashboarding. Member Davis, you had another comment?
Just with the enrollments, I mean, you know, we have to also realize that we're always going to get a certain quota going to Blue Hills, and they should go to Blue Hills, that, you know, whether it's 20 students, 15 students, I mean, usually it's between 15 and 25, depending on the space allocation. And so that, I mean, we're always going to have that, so we're never going to retain 100%. And if a student, if Blue Hills is the place for them, of course they should go. So,
well, add to that,
I
will add to that that I think that, you know, if you have a quarter of your students who are going, you know, to not only to Blue Hills, but to the Aggie school or some of the private schools, we understand that. I mean, I think that a reasonable figure, but, you know, when it was up in the 40s, obviously there's something terribly wrong, and I'm glad
that
hopefully
that
we're getting that right. And if we can even get it less, then that would be extraordinary. Well, all right. We'll please continue, Dr. Lally. Next, you said, on your report, I noticed it says building update.
Right. So we have been meeting on different aspects of the building. So, for example, Cheryl Flynn and I spoke about the specialized equipment in the bathrooms that needed to be in special ed rooms. So that is one of the pieces. So they Consigli and Flansburg consult with us on a regular basis to ask for these types of things, so it's ongoing. Telephone lines, they've just made a request about finding out how many telephone lines we need in this new school. One of the biggest problems right now, though, is watering the two new fields because of the water ban and the drought. So it is going to cost a little bit to bring water in to water those fields so that we don't lose them. After such a great start with the softball and the baseball fields. So that right now is one of the big concerns, and but I believe they have contracted with a company to take care of that. another point of interest, I think, is that the copper delivery will be coming in a couple of weeks. Copper is going to be on the front of the building, and so people are anxious to see what that front is going to look like. So it's, they're going to try out some pieces in a couple of weeks to see just how that you know, fits on, but it probably won't be the full front for quite a while. But at least they're getting the copper now. They're closing up a lot of the areas and making them weather tight, so that should be done in the next month. It should be completed so that they can work inside during the winter months. And one of the other things that we are looking at is we had a couple of keying meetings already. So the whole system for the keys in the building and in the concession stand. So we're going to have another one of those next week, because there are so many levels of security involved in that that it really does take a lot of collaboration. We are also looking at the security measures, and we have a number of cameras, quite a few throughout the building, you know, somewhere around 200. And we also are having Raptorware, which is a kiosk in the two entryways. So one on the elementary wing and one on the secondary wing.
What is that?
So that's a, you would come in with your, so a visitor would come in. We have a vestibule. The first door, you would be led into the first door, and inside the first door in that vestibule, so you can't get into the rest of the building yet, there is a kiosk that would have this Raptor where you put your license into it.
Wow.
And if you pass the check, so it connects with police records, and if you pass the check, you would have a badge printed out, and then they would let you in through the other door. If not, you would not be able to enter. So it's another added security measure that is going to, I think, enhance the the building. So those are the major things that are going on right now, but you know, they are working inside and out constantly, so it's really impressive seeing what's happening.
Dr. Ella, you mentioned key access. Will it be a physical key, or will it be card?
Some will be card access, but a lot will be key, because the cards are so expensive that if you really, you know, do the whole thing in cards, it would be astronomical. So we do have some areas, some swipe cards for some areas, and for example, if you had a computer lab, that might be set on a key swipe card, so that people can't have regular access and, you know, keys being lost and people walking around with keys and handing them off. So there are some more secure areas than others, but I think the, you know, so for example, the pass-through between the elementary and the secondary wing will be in a lockdown all day, so it has a swipe card that only certain people will have.
Are there any other questions?
Just where are you with the furniture? I know you had a group of
right.
people that were looking at it.
And now we're the principals are collecting two volunteers from each building, so we're going to do that, take care of. We're going to find out who those people are, and then we're going to set a date for. We talked about it this morning at the Consigli meeting, and we're hoping to do it at the end of September.
Oh, okay.
And my understanding is you're hoping for the next meeting to have some sort of a draft of a transition calendar.
Yeah, some of the major points are coming up.
Good. All righty, so please continue. I see under personnel you have quite a few new hires.
Oh, yes. We've been very fortunate. Let me see if I can get that page up here. Very fortunate to hire some, our principals have been very good at hiring some new people who really are fitting in well with the vacancies. So the first one is Jonathan Lott, who is the new Latin teacher. And so that's filling that Latin position, but we're starting out with an exploratory in the junior high and a class in the high school. Plus he's, you know, to give him more in his schedule, he's doing a world cultures class, which is kind of aligned to what he's doing. DeSantos is the physical science physics teacher, taking the place of Mary Mingles. We have Nicole Flynn, who is now a paraprofessional at the JFK. Cassandra Regan was here before, and now she's back in moderate special needs at the junior senior high school. John Milhaven is a long-term sub for science at the junior senior high school. And Rachel Nuclerio is the long-term substitute for the grade five teacher at the South School. So very close to the beginning of school, and unfortunately we lost Elizabeth Wilkie, who lives quite a distance, and she found a job that was close to home. So we hated to lose her, but we wish her well.
Does the board have any questions regarding personnel? All right. So we'll now, and welcome to all the, I believe Vice Chair Tolson spoke at the orientation.
I did.
And I hope, thank you for doing that. And everything looked pretty enthusiastic.
Oh, I would say, yeah.
Great.
People were ready to go.
All right, so now we have a Section B, School Improvement Plans.
And Dr. DeMello will be first up.
Evening, folks. How's everybody?
Very good, thank you. How are you?
Did you put the paper?
No.
Oh, sorry, take it down.
Because it has a slide.
Good summer?
Yes.
Very good. Ready for the spring presentation?
Yes.
We're excited about our school improvement plan. So last year, our school council met several times to design a plan, get a lot of feedback from a variety of people, but we'll take you through that as we go. Oops, what happened to the slide? Well, we lost one somewhere already. So I want to thank the members of the school council who are here, and others as well, but we have Anthony Spizzaro from Holbrook Co-op, Patricia Greeley, who's representing our parents, and Karen McDonough, who's also representing parents. This senior folder, I also like to thank Marie Gordon, who was a parent, Andrew Flanagan, who was one of our other teacher reps, and Margaret Morris, who was our student rep. Okay, so the first goal that we have, I'll just kind of go up, take you through our major goals, and then you'll see the handouts. I believe you received one, a copy of the PowerPoint presentation, but you should have also received a copy of the actual school improvement plan that lists some additional columns that I'm not highlighting here. I didn't want to get into too much minutia, but I just wanted to be able to give you a little bit of an overview. So one of the key goals we had was to enhance student knowledge in the area of health and wellness by offering health programs and integrating health and wellness related topics across the curriculum. I'm happy to say we've already started that process. We have implemented health into our seventh grade exploratory courses as a start, but health is an important requirement from the state that we get in. And it comes with a lot of different subjects that we aren't necessarily currently addressing the way we'd like to. Some of the key ones are in this first column: depression, suicide, bullying, nutrition, drugs and alcohol, healthy relationships and dating, and sex education. And so we currently have very limited, targeted, formal programming to address some of these. Some of you may also have heard that there are standards that are coming out to help address, from the state, to help address some of the really concerning mental health and emotional needs of students. So when those are released by the state, we will incorporate those into this as well. So again, we're going to be, when we present the budget, I'm hoping to have further implementation around health and wellness, and having some of this not just be in classroom format, but also programmatically through across all of the grades with specialized programs that the guidance department has helped out considerably with. Any questions on that goal? Second goal, enhance student performance in the areas of developing a variety of life skills. We had a lot of discussion about this. One of the things I will say that I think the committee will agree on, I feel most happy about, is this school improvement plan really reflects what we felt were the needs of the school. And we had a lot of conversations in the process. And when we met, then we went out, talked with staff, community members, so on, came back and shared information. And this one is one that definitely surfaced as key. Things that we're looking to tie in are financial literacy, independent living, public speaking, employment, a better understanding of how you go about getting a job and how to prepare yourself for that, time management, decision making, note taking and study skills, and career choices. And I will tell you with this, just so you can see how we've started to carve this path already, we redesigned our capstone project from last year. So last year it was embedded in the English courses. Now it's an actual separate course that every student is required to take. We have a capstone handbook that we've developed to help guide students. It incorporates many of these skills. So that's one of our big steps. As we move forward into the new building and we're looking at possible new schedules, we're also going to be hoping to have opportunities where our students can, especially our seniors, have an opportunity to leave on a few days to go out and actually conduct interviews or do short internships, that kind of a thing. So lots of good plans moving forward. Anything on this? Again, more details are in your packet if you need it. Okay. A third one, to enhance student performance in the areas of digital literacy and technology. We talk an awful lot and see kids on their devices all the time, and we make the assumption that they're digitally literate. Well, they're digitally literate, but in a large capacity, that's around a small number of social media tools. But it really doesn't mean they're proficient in how to use, for example, an office suite. If they were to have a job, how to do a graph out of Excel, how to put even a PowerPoint presentation together, how to embed links and so on. So there's lots of information that we really have not been addressing here in Holbrook. And so this year, again, as we start to kick off some new initiatives, we have a new computer science program that we've put in. We had Mr. Monteith and Mr. Oliveira attend a computer science training program this year. We've put in our first full year course of computer science. So we're excited about that first step. And of course, throughout the year, as we prepare to move to a one-to-one environment next year, we're really going to be working with the assistant superintendent on professional development programs that will help prepare the teachers so that they can make effective use of the tools they have in front of them. The technology is only as good as it is as any other tool, so it's how we're going to become effective with that. A fourth goal is to help students develop cultural learning and innovation skills necessary to be contributing citizens in the 21st century. So some of those include the life skills that we talked about in a previous slide, but we also saw some other things that we wanted to have stand out that are really pretty well known in the education field now as key 21st century skills. So what's commonly known as the four C's, communication, collaboration, critical thinking, and creativity is something that we want to infuse across all of our curriculum. Ensuring that students have a global perspective. We have the, for example, this month we'll be celebrating World Peace Day with a week-long celebration of activities in September that will coincide with, I think, a previous presentation you had on the Peace Pole and things. So we're trying to find ways of tying all these things together, as well as tying some of the activities that are happening at the South School, so that when we become one building, we can see these things merging a little bit more cleanly. Again, life skills, and then finally the technology. So those are all our 21st century skills. And then finally, to expand our after-school offerings. This is a real concern, is how many of our students are leaving without something to do. And unfortunately, Holbrook is a community that doesn't have a community youth center for students to go to. And compared to some other communities, perhaps not as many town-run activities as well in terms of a variety of athletics and so on. So we really want to get our students involved. So this year, for example, we're adding a mock trial program. We're excited because that obviously has a strong academic component to it. We're hoping to get more students in for some weight room activities and so on. You know about our robotics, but we're going to have a more vibrant health and wellness after school fitness program. I think we're off to a good start in trying to add to that. We're also going to try to infuse homework club into our already existing detention time so that kids can come into that classroom under the same supervision and perhaps get some additional supports. So that's sort of the fire hose version, but what I'm most happy about again is that I really feel this reflects what the needs of the school are right now and for the next couple of years. And after it went through the committee process, the entire plan was then brought in front of department heads to tease some more things and talk about it, and then, of course, brought to the full faculty for endorsement, which it was endorsed. So thank you again to the folks who participated in this.
I had a question. First of all, you said there's no community youth center. What typically is in a community youth center?
A lot of towns will actually have a youth center, which is a place really for kids to go after school to hang out, kind of like seniors have a senior center. It's for students after school.
A Boys and Girls Club type of thing.
It might be something that's, that has a national brand to it, but it might also just be that community's center or room where kids can go and you know, play pool, play cards, games. Sometimes they'll have old-fashioned pinball machines and things for them to play. It's they may have a basketball court depending on the facility, but it's a place for youth to go and gather in communities, and you know, many communities have a place for kids.
I also, before I turn this over, I'm sure the committee has a lot of questions, I wanted to compliment you on your reaching out to the community and the obvious hard work that the community has put into this. It shows, also the faculty input shows, and the critical issues and strategies, and that's, you know, the lifeblood. We all have to work together, you know, in these schools, and this is a good example of when it works and it shows. And I just want to thank those present, and please thank everyone else who was involved in this, and you as well. Please communicate that. I'm sure I speak for the community when I say that.
Yeah.
Are there any questions?
I have a question. I'm curious to hear how the school council has been going, because I think it's been inactive in recent years, and I'm glad to see it.
Yeah, we got off to a little bit of a slow start trying to get folks on board and get the word out that we needed community and parent support. But you know, once we were able to do that, I would say we had some pretty good, healthy conversations that really felt like we were making progress at the end of every meeting. So I think we're on a good start now, and we'll be meeting regularly.
Good. I'm glad to see it become more active again. That's a good thing. It's important.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Portland, especially since it's required under state law.
Yeah,
but I noticed, first of all, I think it's great. It's very to the point, not too many goals that, you know, not too much that couldn't be accomplished in a reasonable time. And I noticed some of the things, like some of the life skills, are things that came out on the survey from last spring. So kind of everything started to coalesce. And at some point, because you'd mentioned that there's now a capstone handbook that can contain some of this, could we see a copy?
Sure.
Okay.
When we've I think it'd be good in maybe a couple of months, we get some.
Yeah,
we've got to get it cranked out and really ironed out some of the glitches, because we're really just getting started, and you know, it's like a pilot year for trying something new. But we'd love to share it, and love to maybe have a couple kids come in and be able to comment on how they feel it's going. And so that'd be great.
Or, you know, even as a tie-in with the program of studies.
Sure.
Because it's all integrated.
Mm-hmm.
That'd
absolutely
be awesome.
Interesting idea.
Yeah. Just one question on
yes.
the health goal. So you said you introduced health this year in grade 7. So you, right now it's not in the other grades
it's
yet.
It's not in any other grade.
Okay. So the
really
goal is to
that will be also,
expand
yeah,
that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. You have to have health programs.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't currently have any. And we want to be able to have venues where we can do a better job at, for example, covering the requirements under bullying policies.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, CPR certification. So, but right now, even just kids needing this is kids the stress they're under these days is tremendous.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have the skills to be able to deal with stress effectively. They need some strategies on how to have healthy relationships.
Where is that? Is like, in other words, learning social intercourse, to be a good listener, to speak in a measured tone. So I saw netiquette, but I didn't see etiquette. Is there some?
Well,
training in that.
That was you were, when you saw netiquette, that was specific to on the internet, which is
right. No, I understand
etiquette.
That.
But
yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that we talk about all the time with students. But talking about it versus having a class where you create opportunities for them to actually learn the skills, and you can do role play and modeling where they get a chance to say, let's say, for example, they're going to a party and there's alcohol being offered and it's their friend, it's their pressure. If that's it, you didn't expect it when you walked in and you didn't know how to handle it, it's very hard. But if you've had an opportunity in school to learn, well, what could you say? How could you still be good friends with them and hang out or stay cool, whatever, and yet respond in a manner that, you know, says, no, it's not something I really wanna do. Mm-hmm. So giving kids skills and how to handle challenging situations.
When to walk out of the situation.
When to step away, you know, what it means to be a leader. We're also starting a leadership program. You might remember in the handbook we added a leadership contract. So that's something that we'll be doing at least four programs this year to try to foster leadership across all of our leadership roles, whether it's in athletics or whether it's in advisory roles, that kind of a thing. So I think all of those things will be really helpful in addressing the skills that we talked about in the improvement plan.
Interesting. Well, I think it's very important. I hope that the parents and guardians will take an interest in that as well. Sometimes I know life is very hectic and people don't feel they have time for it, but it's very important, you know, if people don't know how to listen to each other, it creates a tremendous amount of extra anxiety that's sometimes needlessly so. And I compliment you for addressing these and these other issues. Are there any other questions for Dr. Miller? Yes.
Just one more comment. That, I mean, this all ties in as almost a precursor or on a parallel track with the whole social-emotional learning that we need to put a lot of those we should be putting more focus on. So,
right, just to see where the state puts out for standards around those requirements.
Yeah. So, another unfunded mandate.
But
or
it's
underfunded.
Needed.
Absolutely.
Needed.
Absolutely.
All right, thank you all very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So, Dr. DeMello is completed, and
Mrs. Stevens is next.
Mrs. Stevens, welcome. Good evening.
So, ours, the elementary one, if you remember, we're kind of in a different time frame. We are essentially.
Excuse me, do we have copies? Would you have copies? Because we don't have copies.
Do we have copies?
Mm-hmm.
I have an original.
Yeah. Yeah. Let me.
Oh, and I meant to say, in the absence of Bridget, Doc.
Almost
doctor. studying to be a doctor. Assistant Superintendent Hamilton has been taking our notes as a recording secretary.
While she's doing that, I can kind of speak a little bit about how this is just, I guess, organized. If you remember, the South School Improvement Plan and the JFK Improvement Plan were very similar because we're
right.
working on similar things. So what we did was we pretty much took the two plans, consolidated them because they are very identical. We're in very similar spots at both schools. And then we could speak to those slight differences as we go through. So this plan, we're going to essentially summarize how we feel we did, and then provide insight into where we'd like to go as we start to develop a new plan as well. So we sent out our invitation letters to fill some of our vacant slots already. We've gotten some feedback. The first parent group meeting is at the end of the month, and they will be doing our election essentially for us. So that's kind of where we're at as far as the structure. This upcoming year, both will be combined. So we're going to combine the teachers at both schools, the community members that we have, so that way we can work on another two-year plan where in 1 year we will be together, essentially. So we have five goals. The first one was to enhance student performance in the areas of humanities. And underneath that just kind of aligns to the strategic plan that the district has. Goal two was to enhance student performance in the areas of STEAM. Goal three was to increase MCAS student growth. Goal four was to improve health and safety procedures. And goal five was to encourage parent involvement and communication in the academic and social progress of students. So we're going to kind of go through each one The packet you're receiving is a little bit more detailed, but what we'd like to do is just kind of talk about what the critical issues were and then summarize, and the columns in between are, you know, a little bit more detailed. So feel free to stop and ask questions as we go. So goal one, looking at humanities. So the things we were looking at for the past 2 years, we really focused on developing and updating a Common Core standards-based curriculum with deep-embedded performance assessments for ELA and social studies that vertically aligned with all other grades.
What does that mean? Can you give us an example of what that means?
Which piece of it? The vertical alignment.
Developing and continuously updating a Common Core standards-based curriculum.
We want a curriculum that's aligned to the Common Core, first of all, because it is, you know, relatively new. So we wanted to make sure that we were focusing on those standards. And then the embedded performance assessments, those are our assessment pieces that are, as it says, embedded within there. So we're doing pre and post tests for a lot of these units.
I guess I just meant, could you give us a snapshot of some course where that is aligned with the, if you can't, that's fine, don't worry about it.
I mean, the ELA units, so basically.
So what's an example of a course where the Common Core standards have been aligned, you know, the curriculum has been aligned?
So for K to six, all the year-long curriculum maps are all.
Take grade one.
Okay, so for grade one, it's broken up into monthly units that are based on, like, fiction or nonfiction, and then we're weaving in the science, the new science standards and social studies standards within it, because before we've isolated so that you taught social studies separate, but social studies and science is your nonfiction, is your literacy. So we're weaving that nonfiction piece in from the standards.
So you're integrating
social studies.
Right, and then you would see that that first grade curriculum carries over into second grade, and we're building on it. So that's the vertical alignment piece, that it's not isolated.
Before it used to be that you're teaching the same thing at each grade level, so then you're not mastering anything. So now we're mastering and then adding on.
I appreciate the pre-K explanation that you gave.
Sorry, that's what I do.
And Mrs. Stevens, thank you, and Mrs. Doros also, thank you for putting the explanation of the acronyms on the bottom.
There are a lot of them.
Yes, there are. It is greatly appreciated.
The second critical issue we were focusing on was to implement the curricula with differentiated instruction, appropriate technology, and best practices based on educational research, resulting in continued student achievement. Next, we're looking at providing interdisciplinary lessons. That's what Mr. Rosa was just talking about, is weaving in the science and social studies into our reading blocks, and projects that allow students to make connections among those content areas. And then we're continuing to refine the DDMs for formative and summative assessments. And then at the JFK level, they kind of had a fifth focus, which was to implement Orton-Gillingham, which is a multi-sensory program for ELA instruction. So that's what we were focusing on, and then the next one, Steph's gonna update you on how we did.
For each goal. So happy to say, so K through six has a year-long curriculum map, month by month, that's aligned with the standards and has an end of the unit SEPA, so a summative assessment for each grade level, K to six. So our next step is really looking at the individualized lesson plans that go with each unit. And then we're always trying to refine assessments to make sure that the higher level thinking questions, and then depending, you know, looking at MCAS, PARC, whatever, that we're using that consistent language and exposing students to the type of language that they might see. So we're always making sure that we're refining the vocabulary and things that we're using. So we always kind of take a look at it and say, you know, can we word this a little differently? Could they see it in a different way? So for example, if they're asking like a main idea question, they could just say, you know, what is the gist or what is the main purpose? It's not always going to be using the term main idea, because they may see it differently, but they all mean the same thing. So that's what we're really trying to do with that lesson plan piece. The other thing for humanities is that at the JFK and the South School, there's a teacher resource library. So what we've done is we've ordered leveled text, and then through the Fountas and Pinnell benchmark assessments, all students are assessed at least 3 times a year, and it gives them a level of reading, so where they are, so they're coded as from A to Z. So A would be like a pre-primer, and Z would be up to 6th grade, so each student has an individual reading score. So we're getting texts that are leveled to match students' readability, so we can start weaving in and making sure that students have in their hands material that they can read all of the time.
And many classroom teachers have even gone above and beyond it, that have taken their own personal classroom libraries and have leveled them as well, which, you know, we've asked to do, but many spend.
If you were doing this 10 years ago, what wouldn't have been in here?
A lot of it was that the one size fits all, that you just had one book and everyone had to read the same book and have the same expectation, and we're really trying to individualize it because students today are so diverse, they have different needs, that we need to make sure as teachers that we're educating them from where they are and then take them to where they need to be.
Mm-hmm.
So again, with the model units, besides for science and social studies, we're working closely with the music teacher and the art teacher, so they're really good about incorporating like songs and art projects that relate to the curriculum, which is great.
How long have you been doing this now? 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years?
I would probably say 3 years.
3 years.
Yeah.
I'd say the last two have been
intensive.
Yes, intensive. Because the first year was really unpacking the Common Core, making sure that the teachers had an awareness of the standards and what they mean, and kind of changing their fixed mindset to a more growth mindset of what Common Core is and what students are expected to do, and then being prepared for college and career readiness. So that's really the first year, was really changing their mindset. So the second and third year was really, okay, now that we have this, let's put it in action and change what we're doing.
We do it.
And then DDMs, Mallory talked about our assessments. Like I said, we're always looking at those more closely. And then at the JFK, all staff were trained in OG, and so they implement daily OG lessons. And there's a scope and sequence for each week of which skill. And then there's at least 3 years that they're assessed, three times a year that they're assessed on, and then all new staff that come in this year will be trained. So
and
everyone's up to date.
One thing that all teachers on the first day of school received was a curriculum binder. So those scope and sequences we talked about, these model units that we talked about, they received it all kind of in one binder, kind of almost like a cheat sheet for them. They have it in, you know, Google Docs and things like that, but sometimes it's easy to have a hard copy right there on your desk, so it was all in a one spot for teachers, and we feel like they appreciated kind of having it all in one place. That way when we do have staff meetings, grade level team meetings, they can bring it and kind of refer to it as we go, refine it. Kind of a living document with them at all times.
That's the joys of teaching. I'm sure the older teachers are saying, bring it on, and the younger teachers have already sort of been trained in it coming in, so that there's a good mixture there.
There is, yeah. But it brings about good discussions.
It does, yeah. Interesting. Barbara?
Do you think it might be possible at some point, it doesn't have to be, you know, in the next month or so, that we could get a presentation kind of the differences between the Common Core and the frameworks and how things are changing, because I often get questions and I don't have real precise answers.
Well, let me put it to you another way, rather than maybe lay that on you. Is there some material that...
I was going to say, there's probably some...
I was going to say,
okay.
We have documentation.
Yeah, I think it might be more helpful, Julie, to put that in the form of a, you know, brochure that somebody might want to look at, as opposed to devoting a meeting to it.
So the next goal is very similar, except it just incorporates the area of STEAM,
mm-hmm.
Science, Technology, Engineering, Arts, Math. And again, we were looking at developing and updating a Common Core-based curriculum with embedded performance assessments for science and math that is vertically aligned with all other grades. So, same situation as the ELA one. We're also looking to implement curricula with differentiated instruction, appropriate technology, best practices, provide interdisciplinary lessons, projects, allow students to make connections among content areas, and then also continue to refine the DDM. So, very similar, but where we're at is a little bit different.
So there's a scope and sequence for K to 6 for the math, which is aligned. The science, because they have the new science standards and they updated them again, we have a sort of outline of topics that we need to make sure that are weaved in. And like I said earlier, we don't want to have that separate. We want to make sure to look at our existing curriculum and make sure that we can weave them in appropriately to our units. So that's really what we need to focus on now in the STEAM area.
And I think, if I could just add to that, I think each grade is at a little bit different of a point, just based on the way we structure our grades. For example, fifth grade, sixth grade are departmentalized. We have some teachers that have really been focusing on, you know, the science curriculum for many years. And so it is a little bit further developed than, say, the first grade one. just because first grade teachers are teaching all subject areas. So when you have somebody that's focused on science, they can obviously devote more time on it.
Mm-hmm.
So a little bit different places, but still something that we want to keep working on.
And again, the model units, like I said, are weaved into the literacy block, and then again, refining the DDMs are our summative assessments to make sure that we're hitting using the literacy skills and then using the content to teach it. So.
The next goal is a tricky one, simply because this plan was written in 2014 when we were doing MCAS, then we switched over to PARC. So really, to I'm not going to read the critical issues because unfortunately we can't assess where we're at. But what we can say to this is that we transitioned to PARC. MCAS 2.0, PARC, where we're at with that in 3 years, 2 years, kind of unknown. So we kind of took a closer look at our DDMs that we have used. So
the STAR data on the computer that the students are assessed 3 times a year in reading and math, that showed positive growth. And then the benchmark assessment in reading, which is 3 times a year, all students went up at least one reading level, and then happy to say that our lower level readers went up at least 2 reading levels within a year, which is great because they're more focused in intervention, which is really good. So we've kept the data and we've been tracking that through the fall, winter, and spring. So we want to share that with you because we thought that was great. And then also they're keeping track individually of the pre and post assessments within each unit. And then we're starting to compare it from 1 year to the next. So,
and also holding data meetings, not only as a grade level team, but individually with myself, Steph, the curriculum office, to specifically talk about individual classes and what's going on there. The fourth goal is to improve health and safety procedures. So we want to establish and develop protocols and procedures to ensure student safety. At a district level, the strategic plan included the crisis manual. It has been updated, so it has trickled down, and we've talked about it with staff, and they are following it. We're constantly reminding them of those procedures and protocols. We conduct fire drills, safety in place. We did those last year, as well as lockdown drills. The police came. We ran through it. We got great reports at both schools that the teachers, students, the entire staff really follow the protocol. So we got very good feedback from the police department. So we'll continue to do that as well. We want to continue to educate students on anti-bullying tolerance and inclusiveness. Happy to report K-26 all have second step at least twice a month, if not every week. And our school adjustment counselors do that with each classroom. And then PBIS, Positive Behavior Interventions and Supports, we started that last year. I can't tell you how many hundreds of awards and acknowledgments we handed out at both schools, everywhere from positive behavior caught being good to perfect attendance to academic achievement. We call it homework heroes. We're just really trying to acknowledge those positive behaviors. So it's really become a part of the school culture, and kids, I know at South School, and I was at the JFK today, JFK kids are coming down bringing those slips, you think that they just won $1 million. And the South School students, they're older, but to hear their name announced on the intercom every morning, again, you would think I was handing them a free car or something. So they get excited about it, so that's good to see.
Everybody needs to be told they did a good job.
Yeah.
We both kicked off the school year with it.
With the back-to-school assembly. So. The next one was to continue to educate students in the area of safety related to computer, internet, and social media use. So at both schools, it's uniform now with a computer policy notice. It aligns to our student handbook. So again, that vertical alignment is important. So that way what they're seeing and hearing in kindergarten is the same all the way up. And then goal 5 is to encourage parent involvement and communication in the academic and social progress of students. It's very small because we've done a lot. Our website is updated weekly, sometimes daily for that matter. We had sent a calendar of events home monthly via paper at both schools, and we try to consolidate a lot of those events so that we're doing the same events at both schools, whether it's a spirit day or just the tomorrow's Friday, we're acknowledging a moment of silence with the Twin Towers. Both schools are doing that. And then in addition, the email newsletter is posted on that as well. messages with the connected electronic calling system to remind families of important dates or events are sent out regularly. Newspaper updates, we've been in the newspaper countless times, and then even better than that, Channel 5 and Channel 7 have come to the elementary schools, and we've been on TV for some great causes last Christmas. If you remember, the Soldiers Club, the Social Club, and the Civic Club rep presence, and Channel, I don't remember if it was 5 or 7 came and put us on TV. So kids are excited. We're excited to show the good things that they're doing. Our Civics Club did an HCAM, and did a public service announcement. Our back to school nights is one of the most attended events, so we really try to use that to our advantage. We have several, the Stoughton YMCA, Quincy Family Resource Center are coming with informational tables, so that way parents, we can provide them with tools and information for them. And then teachers went through training to develop classroom websites, so those are becoming up and running and being used more frequently for parents to get more information and feedback. The next one is to offer parents, guardians, educational workshops in the areas of high interest related to academic and social skills. We sent a parent survey out in the spring of 2015. The turnout wasn't as great as I had hoped for, but the response is still information that we use. I think looking forward, we want to do it earlier in the year. We did it about in May of 2015. It was the end of the year. At that point, we weren't using the email constant contact program, so it wasn't sent up email, it was via paper. So I think that could have hindered our results. But we asked questions simply about homework, about your student's child's attitude towards school. So we got some useful information, but I think, again, we want more bigger turnout for that. So.
And then we also held several Title I parent nights. And then we also had a STEAM night, which was a great success with the big ones like bedtime story hour. And then we did like a literacy passport around the world kind of thing, where the kids had a passport and they went to a different reading center and did an activity, and the parents could make the activity with them and could take it home to use it as well. So those were two of our bigger events. And then after each event, we'd send home a survey to say, what did you like, what can we do better, and what additional training or workshops parents would like to see. And a lot of it was things that they can do at home with their students, and then integrating technology were the two things. So that's something that we need to look on going ahead about offering workshops in those areas.
And then lastly, we wanted to improve full day attendance statistics by reducing instances of tardiness through increased accountability for absences not related to illness. So, those students coming in just 5 minutes late, on a regular basis when you do the math, 5 minutes late, 20 times a year, that's a significant amount of time. It adds up. So our adjustment counselors have been tracking attendance weekly. We used to kind of track it, maybe at the end of the quarter, at the end of the month. And at that point, you can look at it and say, ooh, wow, should have been ahead of this. So now our adjustment counselors look at it at the end of each week. And then we send letters to just inform parents that sometimes they don't even know. And it's just a matter of getting that letter and informing them that at this point, your child's been late 7 times or absent 6 times. So that's helped. We often get a lot of phone calls like, oh, I didn't know, I'm sorry, I'll get up earlier. So it's had a positive trend. We also then have been holding meetings and conferences with parents to address, attendance concerns and figure out a solution to get them there on time. And then Connect Ed phone calls go out to notify parents when they are absent, just so that parents know, both parents know. Sometimes, split homes, one parent may not be aware. So just trying to communicate more with them and let them know that, the importance of attendance. So.
Are there any questions? None. Thank you for a very thorough presentation.
Yeah.
We appreciated that. And, we look forward to hearing continued progress on this very critical part of a child's education. The next item on the agenda is a transportation update, and I'm assuming that Trish Lugo, our school business administrator, is going to give that update.
Excuse me. Well, we reached out to First Student to come in and sit with us and answer any of your questions or go over any issues. However, this is, of course, the busiest time of the year for busing, and while we might be in our second week of school, some school districts just started this week. So we in Holbrook have worked out a lot of the kinks, let's say, but in other districts, they're still at that the first few days of school. So first student could not attend tonight. They have agreed to come on October 20th and answer any questions, give an update. By then, we hope to have a meeting with them as well regarding the new school and the changes in the routes due to the fact that JFK and South will now be in the same building, etc. So we'll have more information for you in October.
How much do we pay them a year?
About $330,000.
Okay. Well, I hoped when the formal request was given that they would have a better answer than will come on October 20th, but that's all right. We'll look forward to hearing from them then.
Great.
All right, so now let's turn to, hopefully we'll have more data to talk about with them at that point. So it may not be the end of the world. The next update is a financial one, and please continue, Trish.
Yes, so I did not provide you any information on the FY16 budget because it had not changed really since the previous school committee meeting.
I see.
And I didn't want to waste the paper, so to speak. So it hasn't changed because we're still reconciling with the town and the town's books because they're two separate accounting systems. Beth.
When do you anticipate that being reconciled?
Well, we've made a lot of progress, and we've reconciled the budget, we've reconciled the revolving funds, we're pretty much have the grants to do left. So we're maybe 85-90% reconciled.
Okay. Now you have provided the fiscal 2017, and what sticks out like a sore thumb?
You know what? I'd have to say there's really nothing sticking out that's not unusual from year to year. Some expenses are paid right up front, so you'll see maybe 100% expended in some categories, and some expenses aren't paid until June, so they'll remain at a 0% expended till the end of the school year. So we watch the budget carefully. Payrolls are going through fine. The purchase orders are going through fine. So there's nothing out of the ordinary, and we're okay for FY17.
It's okay. So in terms of tracking purposes, anyone have any questions about the report?
Actually, I have one question, Trish.
Yes.
The one thing that jumped out at me was the private tuitions.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows a large encumbrance of $80,000 spent, over $1 million encumbered, resulting in $500,000. Spent on that line item.
Mm-hmm.
Has something changed since we formulated the budget that would lead to that? And it's in the operational expense mm-hmm. account balance.
Right.
Before.
I see it, yes.
Yeah.
Would anything be, it's on page 5.
Yeah.
Sure, you might want
to.
So that our best estimate is that line item will be overspent by that amount this year. Okay. All right.
The other thing is this doesn't include any circuit breaker at
Correct.
This point in time.
Correct.
Which we always use to.
Right.
Which is meant for that.
Costs.
Right.
Right. So this is just out of
the budget.
The state line, as it were.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that's not an actual overspending at this point, it's just with the encumbrance.
Exactly.
Projecting the end of the year. I just wanted to know what might have changed. So.
Okay.
Any other questions? All right. Now, we also had the issue of, in terms of tracking purposes, let's do this. When do you anticipate, so we would like to track this a little bit, when do you anticipate a reconciliation of fiscal year 16.
To have it completed?
Correct.
Probably next week.
Okay. So you can give us a report at the next meeting?
Absolutely. At the next meeting, I think is September 29th. Mm-hmm. The end of year report is actually due September 30th.
Right.
So by that time, my report, my financial report for FY16 has to be ready for the Department of Ed for September 30th.
That's correct.
So by the next school committee meeting, you'll have all that information.
Okay. And what about the tracking of the various activity fees?
Yes. So you should have in your packet 4 pages, I believe, of the student activity accounts for the school district. And while it is not required for the school committees to vote on these student activities each year, it's a good idea for you to see them and to be familiar with them, and question any of them if you have questions. So the first page is regarding the high school student activity fundraisers, and you'll see we have a list of all of the items that are collected by the students for fundraisers or on behalf of the students. For instance, the pictures, this picture company donating monies to the school for student activities. So the students might not have fundraised for that, but it goes into their student activities account. So these are all of the accounts for the high school. I think, Marianne, you had, I sent you the copy of that, and I guess it's all inclusive then. There's nothing missing. Okay, yeah.
And where's page 2 of the list?
Okay, so the page 2 should be the next page. This
is a question.
I have two.
Okay, we'll get to those in 1 second. Let me just get this thing straight.
Okay, there should be 4 pages altogether.
Is page 2 the summary?
Yes.
Okay,
so let me just say this to you. My understanding was these would sort of be segregated accounts, and it'd be like money in, money out.
Yes.
I don't see that here. So what's that all about?
Yes. Well, for the next school committee meeting, I'm going to have for you all of the balances in those accounts. And if you want to see what has come in and gone out, we can do that too.
And also there has to be, as I recall, some sort of accountability of the money used and some sort of statements signed or filed by the people who receive the money.
Oh, there is. Yeah, there's an awful lot of paperwork.
Yeah, so I'd like to see all. I think we'd like to get a snapshot of that.
Okay.
Because I think that's important. And I mean, at least on a quarterly basis, I think we should. I think we have a need to look at that to see it. I didn't want to interrupt. I'm sorry. I spoke up. What members wanted to comment?
Well, go ahead, Barbara. I bet you have the same question.
Wait a minute. Vice Chair Tolson will stop you.
I'm just wondering, you know, I'm looking at the list here, where the music productions and the money that's brought in and expended, where is that reflected?
Right. The music, Patty, you might know the answer to that one. There is,
I think that is, that money is handled by the Booster Club.
Yes.
How do you
so
mean?
They are not a school group, they're a booster club. So, for example, athletics has, you know, different ones have a booster club too, and they handle their own monies.
So you're saying none of the money that goes into theatrics is town money?
No, we pay for buying, for example, the license to a musical.
Yeah, royalties.
Right. And then, but the money raised by this booster, the Drama Booster Club is handled by the Booster Club.
Well, why don't we see that? I think we have to be transparent with these things.
They're not supposed to be a school affiliate. They're not supposed to be a school organization, and they're not supposed to be included in our record keeping.
I'm not saying that they should be, but I mean, it seems people are paying tickets to a function, and it doesn't say on it the proceeds go to the Booster Club, does it?
I don't know what it says on
that. Doesn't it just say ticket to the concert at the junior senior high school?
Well, there's no admission charge for any of the concerts. It's only the musical, and it does say Holbrook Music Parents Presents.
Right. Well, it would be nice to have, I know that you don't have a requirement to do it, but it would be nice to hear from the Boosters what the arrangement is. You know?
I'm sure they would. They'd come and speak about it.
Mm-hmm. I have no problem with, you know, active Booster clubs. I support them. But, I mean, it would just be nice to know, and I think people would like to know, you know, those sorts of things, and particularly where the auditors are pointing out, you know, discrepancies in accounts. I just want to, I think the point of Vice Chair Tolson's comment was we want to make sure that every account is adequately and accurately placed on here. And I'm assuming, are they given numbers? Is each account given a number and so on?
These are all account numbers.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
So, did you want to say something in addition to that?
Yeah, my question is actually different.
Oh.
This list is just those that have had fundraisers, because I noticed that football and basketball are not on this list, nor is softball.
Okay.
All of the other sports are.
All right. So is...
No, I'm just... it's just fundraisers.
Okay, so on the second page are the athletic fees.
Right.
So that would be for any of the other athletic teams that are not on this list.
I think this is going to be, I may be wrong about this, but my sense of this is this needs to be done like in the spreadsheet sort of format, so we can see the account, the monies that go in, the monies that go out on each particular line item, you know, whether it's a fee or it's a whatever it is, and because I'm assuming that's what the auditors are going to look at. They're not going to look at this.
Right,
so they're
going
to say, what is this?
Right.
Just what we're saying.
It's so, it's in QuickBooks, so we have all those reports, so that would be easy to get for you.
Right. Yeah, I think that would be, is that the sense of the committee, that would be a little more comforting?
I don't know, but Mr. Chairman, the principal can actually answer that question.
If you want, I can just answer, just quickly, Trish, I need to get you to back up fully on the rest of that, of the list, but as the year goes on, different athletic events or activities will put in for fundraisers, so we may not necessarily know right now who may be doing for the upcoming year. I think what I'm hearing from you might be make the most sense is to just list all of our clubs, because at one point or another, a lot of them have that potential for that.
And I don't think it's limited to fundraisers. I think it's if there's money that's been allocated that goes in and that goes out, that has to be accounted for. So that's what I think, you know, we would like to see, because that's what the, obviously this is what the auditors have requested to look at. So we don't want to be the last to know. We would like
right.
to see
yep.
it up front.
Absolutely.
And Member Flanagan.
And hearing you speak about seeing the spreadsheet format of it and wanting to know more about what's happening. It sounds like the beginnings of a policy. And I don't know if we have policy surrounding student fundraising.
It is a very extensive policy, which I'm sure is in drastic need of an update.
Well, that's my suggestion, either that we review the existing policy
yeah.
or create some new policy. It sounds like
well, I'm glad you brought that up, because the policy committee has been reviewing the various policies, but in light of this, conversation and format, I think we will look at that.
Yeah, there are actually multiple policies.
Yeah, there are.
The policy that has the dash E or the dash R.
It's a fairly large policy book, so we've been trying to do it predictably, but I think we can take this out of.
Yeah.
A sequence.
Right.
Flanagan.
Right. Where this has money attached to it, I think it's pretty important to get the
right. But I think the data and how you're preparing it for an audit under their guidelines is what we would like to see.
Sure.
Okay. Well, why don't we take this other information under advisement, if that's all right, pending a review of that, and that'll also give members a chance to digest this a little better. We'll now, are there any other questions of School Business Administrator Lugo?
No, I'm all set.
Seeing none, we'll now turn to discussion items under School Committee Goals. I believe this is probably I don't think we did the third reading of that policy, so I wanted to do the third reading. That's why we have, this is about the alcohol and drugs and the tobacco, alcohol, tobacco, and drug use. Pretty sure that's what that is.
Yeah.
So, would someone like to make a motion on the third reading of those?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor? Those pass. Became an action item. School Committee Goals. This was a bit out of the reading of the policies. Let's see what we have for School Committee Goals. Is there anything listed here? So we're going to leave that off for now. Okay. Now, the next item is the audit committee appointment. I think everyone's had a chance to look at that bylaw. And my reading of it, or my sense of it is, I agree with some of the members of the committee, that it would make more sense to have staff be engaged in those conversations. So my suggestion would be to have our school business administrator be our designee. Would someone like to make that motion?
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor? Welcome aboard. We will announce that to the town administrator tomorrow.
Add it to the list.
Okay. You are a direct designee of the school committee on that. So.
Okay.
We'll be the budget committee, I think, will be speaking to you on that.
Great.
With regard to subcommittee member reports, are there any subcommittee member reports? Yes.
Just a tiny one. I've kind of been working on updating the survey. I'm not done. And so if we could put it on the agenda next week, I will have it done after consulting with various people and have it in the packet.
Okay, so we can put that on for a discussion item at our next meeting. All right?
Thank you. I mean, I know the goal was to get it out.
That's all right.
For next week, but that wasn't happening.
That's okay. That happens, and that's predictable and expected. Are there any other subcommittee member reports? We gave a brief one about the policy subcommittee, and that's an ongoing affair. We will analyze this and look for the next meeting, give a little report on what we have looked at so far. I will say this, we did give a directive to the department here to make sure that whatever is online is in the handbook, because that is, there are people that don't have access to the internet, and that is part of our policy, that it be in paper form. So we want to make sure that that, at a minimum, is the same. Okay, so we'll add that to the list. We'll have a report for discussion of the policy subcommittee at our next meeting. Now, school committee members report. Are there any members who would like to make a report? All right, member Davis, what would you like to report?
Didn't know that was going to happen. I attended a well-attended kindergarten and seventh grade orientations. Really impressive, the number of parents that came out on two very, very warm evenings. I was also at opening day. Girls and boys soccer and volleyball all won their opening day games yesterday. The first football game is this Saturday at 11 o'clock at Marciano Stadium, and back-to-school nights begin next week.
Thank you. Any other reports? Seeing none, We will now, we've done the committee policies, we'll now let's select a delegate for the Mass Association of School Committees. Is there anyone that's interested in being a delegate?
Why is everybody looking at me? You know I'm the only one that's going down on Wednesday.
All right. So would someone like to make a, would someone like to make a motion to...
I nominate Barbara Davis as a delegate.
Second. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All those in favor? So moved. Okay. Congratulations.
Actually, I enjoyed it last year.
Good.
It was really neat.
Good. Glad you
and
did.
And the stuff is just got posted just today. The
agenda?
Yeah, the agenda for the delegate assembly. Yeah. Probably what you would expect and not any surprises.
I'd like to say I did the year before, but I don't want to lie, so... All right, so our next item is the school committee meeting minutes of August 18th. Does anyone have any amendments to those? Yes.
It's just really minor, but my comments are in the school committee subcommittee report as opposed to the regular report. It wasn't a subcommittee report, it was a regular report. And I know it's semantics, but...
Okay, well, I think
category.
We can amend that, and would someone like to make an amendment to the Barbara's amendment? We'll take that as being amended. All those in favor of accepting the minutes, would someone make a motion to accept the minutes as amended?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Is there any old business? Is there any new business? Yes,
I have something, maybe. I would just like to ask the committee to consider passing a resolution on ballot question 2. I have information, I mean, for the next meeting, because I have a packet of information and a draft resolution. And because.
Why don't you do this? Why don't you forward a copy of that to Bridget, and we'll circulate it and we'll put it on the agenda for the next meeting?
Okay.
All right. Okay, any other new business?
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. All right, I'm go to the order. Is there any motion?
So moved.
Second.
To adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
This meeting is adjourned.